We also would welcome you to use the chat box on both Facebooks and on Zoom with any questions you may have, and we'll be sure to get those answered. So with that, I will turn the presentation over to Kathy and John. Welcome and thank you.
You are very welcome. John mentions, I think he's posted in the chat room, everybody, the link to today's materials, and there it is on the slide. We're going to talk, John Brandt and I from MainSight are going to talk about a family guide to assistive technology and accessible educational materials. So welcome. We are the team from the MainSight program. I'm Kathy Adams. My background is as an occupational therapist with more than 30 years of experience in working here in the state of Maine. And my colleague, John Brandt, works with me at MainSight, and he and I are the team today. John is the training coordinator for the MainSight program. And there on this slide, as well as in the chat, is the link to our website and the guide itself, which was just rolled out earlier in the month of June. It's the 2020 version, updated version of the main guide for assistive technology and accessible educational materials. So the next slide. MainSight, let's tell you who we are. I hope you might know who we are, some of you here. We are the state of Maine's assistive technology program. There is an assistive technology program in every state in the country. We are funded through the Maine Department of Education, and they receive those assistive technology monies from the federal government. So it comes from the federal government to the state of Maine DOE to the MainSight Assistive Technology Program. So we're the statewide AT program. And our job, whether we're in Maine or whether in New Hampshire, Maine, New York, California, the ATAC programs, our job is to work full-time to promote information around assistive technology and knowledge about AT, to provide educational and training events on assistive technology, to provide technical assistance on assistive technology. And we run three websites, which those three websites are very, very robust with information. We are always working on those websites, mainsight.org, mainaim.org, and our third site is atformaine.org. And we're going to talk about all three of these as John and I move through the presentation. But in order to be working in this arena, absolutely, we are collaborators. We have to collaborate, and we do collaborate with lots and lots of entities here in the state of Maine. AT providers are a big group of collaborators that we work with. Organizations who provide AT services, organizations who are in the disability services business. We do work very closely with Carrie and her team at Maine Parent Federation. We work with the Disability Rights Maine. We work with 20 or 25 organizations across the state, all involved with providing disability-related services. We also work with policymakers, which is very, very important because that is the overarching, policy is the overarching information that promotes and makes AT available to people across the state. So those are some many of the aspects, encompassing aspects of the work that we do. Next one. So we work, as all AT programs in the country, we work with consumers and individuals of all ages and all types of disabilities. So that's, so we do work with educators and therapists and school systems and early intervention providers. We certainly do. But at the same time, we work with adolescents who have disabilities, adults who have disabilities, and seniors who have disabilities aging is impacting their functions. So it's across the board, individuals of all ages and all disabilities. In these four areas, education, which is our discussion today, employment, which we will also touch upon, community living, which we'll also touch upon, and information technology and telecommunications. So these are all the areas that we work and have knowledge about regarding assistive technology. Next one. What is AT? AT, the phrase assistive technology has been around for years and years. It was identified 30 plus years ago in the disability services field. It's kind of interchangeable. I've been around all those years, so it can be adaptive technology, assistive technology, rehabilitative technology, devices, adaptive devices. So there are many terms that you might see in documentation and in literature, but the bottom line is that an assistive technology device is any device, any item, any system, or any piece of equipment or product which will make an impact on the functional capability of the individual child who has a disability. So, and in this day and age, most of those products are commercially available, out-of-the-box, everyday technology, much of it. But still, much of it is customized because children, young children with disabilities quite often are needing customized devices, equipment, and technology. So it's a broad definition, but equally important to the definition of the device itself is the services. AT services will help the child or the student and their family and their school personnel to learn about what AT options they have in a certain area of function and help them decide what particular devices will be of best benefit to them. So here's a picture of a couple of young children, both of them with mobility issues, both of them using adaptive customized mobility devices and technology for seating customization. And the top picture, the young child is using, it looks to me like a communication device that had to be adapted on a bracket so that it could be within reach of that child to be able to touch the tablet device and use it for communication. And then below it is a young boy who's using an adapted child's wheelchair for a sports activity to enable him to be more mobile and to be more agile out on the gym floor playing that game. So just a couple of examples of customization. Next one, John. I'm going to take my picture down now. I guess I don't need that anymore. Thank you. Technology is universal in our lives. I think if we could all raise our hands, we would probably all raise our hands and agree with that. It's universal in our lives. And I suspect it's going to be universal in the lives of all of our children as they learn to function more and more independently, grow up, function more independently, mature and grow into their disability. And so assistive technology can make an impact on function. And as an occupational therapist, that's my bailiwick. That's the bailiwick of most of the therapists working in school systems. They're working to enable their students and the children to function and to maintain and increase their abilities. And all of these areas that are mentioned here on this slide, obviously learning, key, number one goal. Communication, number one goal. And these goals can begin very, very early through the early intervention system. All of these can begin very early, and they can be built upon as the child grows up and grows into their disability and they mature. Safety is key. Those children in those mobility wheelchairs in the previous slide, safety was key for both of those children. You do not want a child being injured as they move into mobility and more sophisticated mobility, such as the young boy in the gymnasium playing the game in that adapted wheelchair. Self-care is critical, skills to be learning functionally for a child. And as they get older and into their high school years and transitioning, homemaking, learning how to manage and being independent living and homemaking. Mobility, we've talked about. Self-determination is a key thread throughout any functional area of life, being able to self-determine the direction that I'm going to go in. Being productive on the job, again, later in life through the high school years or college years or transition period, looking at areas of productivity and work productivity. Participating in the community, participating in groups, participating in the classroom, participating in sports activities or field trip activities, all of those areas of function and enabling participation. Social connections are critical. Transition is critical. John's going to talk about that in more detail. And inclusion is the ultimate goal, inclusion and participation. Next one. This is key, and this is highlighted in the family guide that we're hoping that you tap into and research off our website and connect with. One of the big messages of the guide, which I think totally jives with the Maine Parent Federation, is family is essential. It is key. It is critical. It is an important part of the planning team. You may engage in various types of planning teams in your child's life as they grow through the early intervention system into schools. Maybe an IEP team, maybe an IFSP team, maybe an ISP team. So we have all of the acronyms, but John and I decided to refer to it all as planning teams, because that's what you're doing. You're critically thinking ahead and trying to look into the crystal ball of your child's future and plan for what their needs will be and their independence and their productivity. So the team with the family at the table is shaping the decisions about what's going to be happening and about what assistive technology the child will explore and end up using, both at home and in school and in other out-of-school settings. And then again, the family is working on the planning team to fully share responsibility on caring for that assistive technology, especially if it is at any out-of-school settings or at the home. So all of that discussion occurs with the team. Thank you. The guide, this is kind of we decided to take out some of the highlights from the table of contents from the guide for Maine Families. Again, it's called the Guide for Maine Families on Assistive Technology and Accessible Educational Materials. Just released in June 2020. And we talk obviously about the involvement of the family. We talk about assistive technology and about how AT can be utilized at the various stages and ages of life, as well as through the high school years in the transition planning aspects that you will work with your adolescent children. We talk about AT evaluations and selecting AT, how to teach students and train students on using AT, but it's not just the student. It may be a small number of people. It may be an ed tech. It certainly may be family members. It certainly may be classroom teacher. It could be gym teacher. It could be any number of people. There may be a small constellation of people that have to be involved in learning and being instructed on the technology and the devices and how it is used. We touch upon in the guide ownership of the assistive technology devices. We also talk about, and John will later, accessible educational materials. And then we talk about resources and funding. So we try to capture as many important aspects as we think you want to know about. And then we're always available as additional resources. We receive information requests a lot from families and school-based practitioners around and special educators around AT. Next slide. So the array of services that are available here in Maine and beyond other states, in other states, is the assessment. AT assessments can be done by school-based professionals, therapists, speech therapists, occupational therapists, physical therapists, as well as consultants, assistive technology consultants. These professionals have the opportunity here in Maine to get their hands on devices for demonstration purposes or to actually borrow the device to bring it into the classroom or to bring it at home So that they can try out the device before they buy it. And I'm going to mention that resource in a moment. So device demonstrations and loans are part of the service array available. Assistive technology device reuse and recycling is available. And I think this is quite often used by families who have children that are outgrowing and growing up and growing bigger and not needing their smaller sized equipment. And so that program is available through Spurwink Alltech, and they accept and receive lightly used assistive technology equipment. They will clean it and refurbish it and recycle and resell it. So there's believe it or not, there's quite a huge need for recycling and reuse of equipment, lightly used equipment. Alternative financing, one of our big areas of concern continually is funding and financing equipment. And alternative financing, cash loans are a big resource available. In Maine, we have the Adaptive Equipment Loan Program, which an example of that might be of a family who, again, the child is getting older. They're now in middle school or going into high school, and maybe they're in a larger size wheelchair and the family needs to consider a van. And so that's an adapted vehicle. So they would be eligible to be able to borrow a loan for that adapted van so that the family would have the adapted transportation that that youngster or adolescent might need, will need. We provide, as I said, lots of information and assistance through Maine Site. John and I are consulting quite often, lots and lots through the course of the week via our connections with people across the state, providing information about details about assistive technology. And then we do quite a lot of training events and webinars on our website. If you do go to our website, please do, mainsite.org. We have a whole section on webinars that we have queued up, yet to be happening and yet to be presented, as well as probably 25 webinars that are archived and on our site available for you to research and go back and listen to at any time. The picture on this slide is a picture of a 9-piece switch set. These switch sets cost around $900, and we have purchased 3 or 4 of them, and they're available for therapists and school systems to borrow if they need to evaluate a student using various types of switches. And so that's an example of a switch, of a multifaceted switch set. And next slide. That switch set is housed right here in this, on this website called at4maine.org. And it is a website that houses more than 1,200 devices and items on it. It's a searchable database. Families can search it, therapists can search it, special educators can search it. And you can look for things on this database, such as that switch set, as I mentioned, or an iPad. We probably have 50 or 75 iPads on the site available for loan. In these four entities on the bottom of the page, Spurwink Alltech, Pine Tree Society, CARES, and the University of Maine Farmington are the entities who house all of this equipment. We do not have it at our little tiny 10 by 10 Maine Site office in Augusta. The equipment is all housed at Alltech, Pine Tree Society, or CARES, or UMaine Farmington. And so they are the keepers of all of those devices and technologies. So when you go on the website to search it, you'll be able to find out where the technology is located. Is it located at Pine Tree in Bath, or Pine Tree in Scarborough, or Alltech in Portland? So you can identify where the technologies are located. So again, this website is available for the public. It's available for people with disabilities to look at, families and caregivers, special educators, educators, therapists. So it's a public website, at4maine.org. We're quite happy to be able to sponsor that and keep it up and running. And we add devices and technology to this inventory every year. So next slide. AT starts early. That's why they call it early intervention. AT is can be introduced very early. And the regional child development services programs do just that across the state of Maine. And they make assistive technology and devices available for children as young as it can possibly be at no cost to the family. Quite often these devices and technologies are identified by the planning team, by the therapists and the families and the who are on the planning team. And each of the regional sites has inventories of technology that they use in their region, and they also share among regions. And we've actually worked with them over the years to create a sharing database for assistive technology that they can share their equipment statewide. So they're responsible, and they do provide assistive technology services, and those therapists in early intervention are quite well versed in assistive technology. Again, that AT can come home if it's identified by the planning team to do so, and quite often should come home. And the AT services that are provided through early intervention, as with older children, always the training would include the family for any instruction or training around using devices. Quite often has to include the family because they need to be knowledgeable about that, especially with younger children receiving early intervention. Next one. Some examples here in the center picture is an adapted toddler seat. You probably have seen these, or maybe your children have used these at younger ages. This would definitely be of a toddler, and it's adaptable in that it enables the child to be practicing being seated with good back support and good support through the pelvis and the hips for seating. This would be a small child, as well as having that activity table be able to be clamped on so that they can be given a toy or an activity to play with or to conduct an activity on that tray, so that they're seating and getting movement in through their trunk and hips and legs, and also having a functional activity with their arms. And this particular device is pretty common in early intervention. The device on the left-hand side is a tablet where a child is touching pictures, not yet reading words, I'm going to say, but just using the tablet to touch pictures to create communication. So again, a younger child using tablet technology for communication. Speech pathologists are always overseeing this area of communication services. That's their area of expertise. And over on the right-hand picture is a young girl who's grown out of that wooden chair in the center picture. She's now in a wheelchair that is moving about with wheels, and she's out on a adapted playground, whether it be a school playground or maybe her town or community, just out having some playtime in the playground using in a sitting position in her wheelchair. Next one. More devices, more technology for early intervention. Way on the left-hand side, this young man is an older child, and he's now gone from the seating chair to a standing table. So he's standing. The therapist wants him to be in an upright position, getting muscle stress through his head and neck and shoulders, down through his trunk and pelvis, and down through his legs, so that he's getting muscle tone and building muscle tone. And at the same time, as same concept, he's got a tray table attached to the stander, and he's doing a functional activity with his arms and hands. So the little one in the middle picture is using one of those switch devices. This is back to a younger child. And this little child has been given a switch device. And when he activates that red round switch, that stuffed toy is probably jumping around or or barking or whatever it might be doing. So he's learning cause and effect and being able to operate the switch to make the toy act, to activate the toy. At the same time, his seating is being his head and neck and trunk, and his seating position is being kept in position by some supports there that you can see that are supporting his head and neck position. Again, keeping his eye-hand, working on eye-hand coordination as he activates that switch. And then way over on the right-hand side is just a couple of kids fooling around. Again, the little girl on the right is in a stander device, and she has her device, her position is set up by the therapist or by the her paraprofessional to be in this position, to be standing and engaging and playing with, participating in another, with another child in a classroom group. I'm going to think that's what that looks like. But next picture.
Kathy.
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about using AT as a reinforcer, reward, or punishment?
Wow.
So the question's posed how it should never be used as a reinforcer, reward, or punishment. Yes.
Thank you. That scared me.
I was waiting. Yeah. There you go. Sorry.
When you said the first sentence, I was just going to say, no way, never, hey?
Yeah, that's exactly what I wanted you to say.
It scared me just a moment there. By rephrasing the, absolutely not. Yeah, that's the type of thing that you probably want to call one of your friendly disability rights attorneys at the Disability Rights Maine, or if you call us, we'll probably tell you to call them, but yeah. What more can I say?
Just don't do it, right?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. Yeah. Where am I? Boy, that one threw me off. Am I here on this? Okay, thank you. Slide 14. So assistive technology also seriously comes into play as, again, the child is getting older and developing much more clearer functional skill areas, becomes very, very important in the special education years, K through 12. And becomes even more critical during transition, and John's going to talk about that. But again, this, it's the same concept. Services are provided by school districts. No cost is imposed onto the family. Quite often, the school system might look to the family to get permission from the family so that their school can seek funding and purchase assistive technology or devices through their Maine Care or Medicaid funding or other health insurances. And that may be completely warranted because in that regard, when that does happen, the child and the family own that device. So it becomes the responsibility of the family. And I'm thinking of a communication device as an example. Quite often families want their children to own their own communication device. And so they do go ahead and seek funding from their own health insurance or Medicaid. But again, that is identified at the team discussion, team planning, conversation with the team, and decision about funding is made with permission of the family if they are going to access the family insurance. AT can come home, as we've said. And I know this spring a lot of AT came home, and it's always good, and we're so much smarter now after our spring experience. Maybe next time you have your IEP meeting, you identify that in writing on the IEP that yes, Kathy's AT can come home with her at any time, and just put that in the IEP and identify when the AT is at home that the family will make a commitment for maintenance and care. So next slide. Here's the plan. AT can be, as we've talked about AT earlier, AT can be the devices and the equipment, certainly, but it must also be hand in hand with the services. So the services are, again, the assessment part provided by the school-based therapists or consultants if needed. And so that the child is being evaluated by a qualified individual and they're going to get their AT needs identified. The AT will be selected what AT is best for them. And again, don't forget that qualified individual, that therapist can use AT for Maine to get their hands on equipment that they may not have in the school. And then they move on from selection to purchasing the equipment to training the child on how to use the device and technology, as well as school personnel, as well as family too. So, and some services might need, might have to be, the team might have to acknowledge that there are maintenance issues on certain types of equipment and assistive technology. So that has to be identified. And in our information guide for families, we outline quite a lot about this to help guide you as you're sitting with your team and making these decisions. Next one. Types of AT can be quite broad. This is a listing of types of AT that was identified 25 years ago at the federal level, and it kind of overarches our funding that we get from the federal government. So it helps us categorize devices and technology as, and again, as an OT looking, matching technology to function. So there are lots of technologies for students who have visual impairment and blindness. So you have vision, all the areas of vision, all the areas of hearing types of AT, all of the devices that fit into speech and communication. Another category is the learning and cognition types of devices that assist with learning and cognition. Then a whole broad category of devices that assist with seating and positioning and mobility. We've talked about some of those earlier. Many, many devices that assist with daily living and the function of daily living and the functions of homemaking as students are growing up in life and taking command and taking over their own daily living tasks. A big area, a burgeoning area, an important area, is all of the devices that assist in managing environments and adapting environments, adapting the house, adapting the work environment. That I call these smart home, smart technologies. But this is a great area for us to become more and more knowledgeable about. So environmental adaptations. Then there's the whole area of vehicle modifications and transportation, as I mentioned earlier. The whole area of computers and related technologies and apps and software, and then the whole functional area of recreation and leisure. So there's assistive technology that can be matched and fall into any one of these functional areas of living. Next one. Assistive technology in schools. There's another student here on the top left who I believe I'm reading the picture right. This little girl is using eye gaze technology to use that pink colored communication board, which is on a customized mount. It looks like on her wheelchair because she has a headrest behind her head. So she's using eye gaze technology on a communication device. And then over on the right, top right hand picture is the tablet technology that I think we're pretty much all familiar with, many of us. Quite often used for communication technology, but also many, many students who are transitioning into adulthood use smartphones with a certain number types of apps to assist them in managing their life. And then the bottom left-hand picture is a little one again using an adapted walker so that he can be playing in a gymnasium and in a class with students in the gym. And then on the right hand side is a manual wheelchair with a rim assist added to it. And this takes a manual wheelchair, which is a standard manual wheelchair, but then perhaps as the child is growing up and getting older, they might need to go into a power wheelchair to get around those long school corridors to become more independent in that environment. But instead of spending $10,000 or $15,000 on a power chair. This is a rim boost wheelchair. And this is just an add-on part that goes on to the manual wheelchair and enables the student to be able to push their wheelchair, but get 2 to 3 times further distance with each push. So it's kind of a stopgap for a student to use, again, as they're growing up with their disability, and quite often used with a student who may have a progressive neuromuscular or progressive mobility impairment. So that's just a rim boost chair technology. Next one. Here's more assistive technology that can come into play. The top left picture is the suite of smart home technology, which I just mentioned. Very, very relevant with students transitioning who are leaving school and maybe going to be home alone for periods of time while their parents are still at work. Or maybe they're going to move into an independent living program and move into their own apartment. Any number of scenarios might be coming up, but smart home technology will be very relevant to those students who are transitioning into independent living and can play a critical role in their independence and safety being in those environments. Over on the right-hand side is a young student who's transitioned and is in a work environment, has a vocational rehabilitation counselor, and that VR counselor has assisted this young man into a work environment, and he has any number of adapted screen monitors and technology that he is using to help him be productive on the job, as well as, not to mention, he's got an adapted power wheelchair to give him the mobility he needs to have in that work environment. And then on the bottom picture is a handheld device to accommodate a vision impairment to a magnifier. It's a digital portable magnifier handheld device for a person to use for enlarging the page and reading. Next one. I think I'm switching, John. Is it your turn?
It is.
Okay, so before we go, any questions pop up? I'm good. Okay.
You're good. Yep, just the one I asked.
Thank you.
Yep.
Thanks.
Thank you, Kathy. This is John Brandt. Hello. Good afternoon, everybody, on this lovely, warm summer afternoon. Before I switch on to transition, I just wanted to go back to this picture of this young man. This is actually a young man by the name of Christopher Hills. I believe he's from Canada. And this picture is taken, he's probably about 14. That's when I first heard about him. He makes videos. He's a video editor. He's a young man who has cerebral palsy and has some difficulty with communication, but that doesn't slow him down, and uses that wheelchair quite effectively. But what's amazing is he is able, with his switch technology, to be able to control all that technical equipment behind him, which is a screen that does editing of video and audio. And he has his own little business now as a young man in his early 20s. Made the impression of the people at Apple Computer that they fitted him with a whole bunch of probably $10,000 worth of equipment. So he's actually a consultant now with Apple Computer on how to use technology in the home and start your own business. So it's a success story. So talking about transition at that point where a student starts to plan to leave the traditional K-12 public school environment and moving on into either post-secondary education or possibly the world of work. And once again, assistive technology is an important part of that transition process. The federal laws and regulations, as the state regulations, call for transition planning to start no later than age 14 or ninth grade. I like to always say you can start it earlier. That's the time when you have to start it, but you certainly can start transition planning earlier. And the planning team, the same IEP team that's been working with the student and working with the family, needs to start to consider issues of transition at that time and put that into a transition plan as part of the IEP. And we've talked about the essential part of the family in planning. When we get to the level of transition, it's also very important that the student participate in that process. We talked earlier about self-determination, self-advocacy. All of the data about successful transition talks about the fact that students who are able to express their needs, describe what their strengths and weaknesses are much more successful in post-secondary experiences as well as work situations. So it's essential that the students be involved. And there's no reason why a student can't be involved in the early grades. I mean, even if it's a first grader, they can certainly spend 5 minutes with the IEP team and talk about what they're doing in the classroom. It's not hard to do. And so they have that experience earlier. So when they get to be in junior high school and high school, they know what the IEP team is and they're familiar with the process. The other critical person that comes to the meeting starting sometime during the transition period is the vocational rehabilitation counselor, the VR counselor. Every school in the state of Maine, every high school in the state of Maine has a VR counselor assigned to it. As if you have a student who is entering high school, you want to find out who that person is and make contact with them. There are several programs that Voc Rehab have available to engage students at that age, and I'm sure there's more information in your school, and I know Carrie and the folks at Maine Parent Federation have more information about that. So in this picture, by the way, we're showing a picture on the right side of an adapted van with a ramp. You can see a kind of a rugged wheelchair there, a motorized wheelchair with, it looks like snow tires on it, so it's ready for winters in Maine. So that's something that Voc Rehab might be involved with the family in terms of identifying what those transportation needs are going to be when the student transitions out of the public school or the high school environment. And the device on the left is a refreshable braille display, a note taker and braille display. Again, this might be a product that Voc Rehab recognizes is something that the student is going to need in a work setting or in a post-secondary setting and may assist in the payment of or finding the funding for purchasing something like that. And you want to get that device while the student's still in high school and can learn how to use it so that when they get to college or get to work beyond, they have the skills needed to handle that equipment. So the transition team needs to consider a lot of information as it plans. You want to have a recent AT assessment. You may have had an assessment when the student was in elementary grades. It's going to be really important that they have an assessment as they move through the transition process. If the student is planning to go to a post-secondary situation, the college disability coordinator is going to want to see a recent AT assessment so they can see the kinds of accommodations the student might need. So it's always good to try to get that evaluation maybe in the junior year of the student's high school or maybe senior year so that information is detailed and up to date. As part of that assessment, the person who's doing the assessment can borrow different AT devices from the AT for Maine program, as we talked about earlier. Try these things out. These may not be things that are customarily used in a high school, so they may want to look for devices that might be used in a work setting. So it's a perfect example of where you might borrow something from AT for Maine. And again, the IEP should talk about what AT is needed and how to use that. Again, once again, family members should learn how to use the AT, as well as teachers and aides. Again, the importance of student self-advocacy skills and look at the kinds of AT that are going to be needed not only in the educational environment, but also at home, at work, and in any kind of a community living situation. And we put that picture again of some smart home technology in this on this slide. Increasingly, we're seeing more we call everyday electronics being used in our lives that can be easily used by people with disabilities to live much more independently. By the way, we do have a webinar on our website that talks specifically about smart home technology. So if you're interested in that topic and want to learn more about it, please check out the training page. Some other things to consider, again, if the student is going on to higher ed, we want to look to reach out to the college support service team, find out what their needs are. One of the things that comes to a shock to a lot of parents when they start looking at post-secondary education is that up until now, all through the preschool and elementary and high school experience, the laws are written in such a way that requires the school to reach out to the family to identify the student with the disability and to provide the programming. And all that changes when the student leaves high school. Now the onus of responsibility is on the individual themselves. The student themselves are the ones that have to identify that they have a disability and they have to communicate what their needs are. Mom and dad actually don't do that for them. The student themselves is expected to be able to communicate with the disability coordinator and communicate what their needs are and what their accommodations are. And that would include not only the assistive technology that they need, but also the educational materials that they have, which we'll talk about in a few minutes. So that's why it's really important that students be involved with their IEP and their transition plan so they know all these things as they're getting ready to go off to either the world of work or the world of post-secondary education. For those students who are going into a work setting, one of the apps that we like to talk about is an app called CanPlan. And it's a program that can very easily be set up to allow an individual to learn the steps needed to complete a task. So if they're going to a work setting and they're going to be doing packaging or they're going to be assembling things, or it could even be for community living skills, how to cook a can of soup, those kind of things. You can actually use this little app to identify the steps, you articulate what the step is, you take pictures of what the step is, and when the student is then doing it on their own, they use the app as a support to allow them to meet each step and indicate that they've completed that step. Again, looking at the transportation needs, the funding sources that are going to be needed to purchase assistive technology after the high school experience is over. And one of the things that's often forgot about that's required as part of the IEP is something called the summary of performance, which identifies all the things we've talked about. And that's one of the things that the college support people really want to see. So you got to make sure that your IEP team has completed that summary of performance. Funding, it's important to realize that up until the end of high school, the school district is responsible for paying for all of the AT services and AT equipment. Parents are not required to pay, but there may be situations, as Kathy indicated earlier, where there may be some equipment that will be used at home and it might be the parents' decision to purchase it themselves and they may use Medicaid funding for that or other health insurance, but that's always done with the parents' permission. The school cannot force the parent to pay for things. And one of the things that we are encouraging people to look at is as part of the IEP and part of the transition planning is to look at the student's future financial needs and to look at what kinds of options, whether they're going to be working and making money themselves or whether there are other kinds of financial situations that the student will need. And so I would recommend that you, again, check our website for resources in this area. We have lots of information about funding, way too much to cover in today's presentation. I will just quickly mention that we are planning to have a webinar this summer about the ABLE Act, which is a relatively new source of financial opportunities for individuals with disabilities and their families to be able to take money and put into a special interest-bearing fund and use those funds to purchase assistive technology. So we'll make sure that you all get an invitation to that webinar when it's coming up in July. So moving on to AIM. AIM stands for Accessible Educational Materials. The original definition of this program was instructional materials, accessible instructional materials. So we obviously called it AIM, but then the federal guidelines changed and broadened it to educational materials, but we're still using the acronym of AIM. So what are AIM? So AIM originally was designed in a world of paper when we had regular traditional textbooks and printed materials, and we had students who had, for various reasons, a need to have those materials converted into an alternative format. So if you had a blind student or a child with blindness or low vision, they may need to have their textbooks in Braille, in hard copy Braille, or they may need it in large print. And so the AIM program was developed about 10, 15 years ago to facilitate a process by which traditional print books could be converted into printed Braille and printed large text. We all then realized that very soon everything was going to become digital, and indeed it has become digital. So probably 80 to 90% of the materials that are used, particularly in high school, but definitely in college, people are using digital versions of those materials. So part of what we have to make sure schools and colleges understand is that when they have any kind of a digital document, it has to be usable by a person with a disability. So part of what the AIM program does is help schools and colleges and businesses and organizations make all of their materials in a format that will work with all kinds of assistive technology. And that would include everything from websites to email to social media to videos, all those kind of things that you need to do to make sure all of your digital content is accessible to everybody. So part of what we do with the AIM program is we provide training and information to organizations and individuals about how they can do that. And so the main AIM program has its own website and has lots of training documents and resources for people to learn more about that. What's important as we talk about AT and AIM is to realize that if you're going to have accessible education materials, you probably will need some form of assistive technology. So we mentioned earlier the refreshable Braille display, as opposed to having a book that's, you know, might weigh 20 pounds and is a big, huge, a hard copy Braille book. They get a digital file that allows that same content to be read on a display, such as the device you're seeing on the left. Or it might be a digital book that's just displayed through a regular browser or through an app on a laptop or a tablet or a phone, where that digital content is converted into speech, highlighted, the text can be changed, all those kinds of things all are done with technology. So again, if the student is going to need the piece of assistive technology, it's important that all be put into the IEP and planned for as you go forward through your educational career and into transition. This is a screenshot of the famous main official IEP form, and section 3 of that form includes the considerations of special factors that are required. And I put big red stars next to the 3 things that relate to AIM and assistive technology. So item 3D asks the question, if the student is blind or visually impaired, does the child require instruction in Braille and the use of Braille? And it gives you an opportunity to respond to that. The E question, 3E, does the child have print disability that requires accessible education materials, AIM, to access the curriculum? And if yes, what type of AIM does the child require? And again, we asked that every time an IEP is developed, that this section be carefully checked. So when you're sitting in an IEP team meeting and somebody just wants to quickly run through this and check off things, make sure you slow people down and say, gee, does my student need to have accessible education materials? And does he need or does she need assistive technology with those accessible education materials? So now you are armed with information that maybe you didn't know about. The G question on section 3 asks specifically about what the AT devices and service needs are. And usually there's someplace else in the IEP form where that's all articulated in greater detail, but be familiar with the IEP form and where those important questions are, and make sure those questions come up in the IEP planning team. That ends our formal presentation today, so we're open to questions. And I'm going to leave this slide up, which has our contact information, and invite you to put your questions in the chat.
I'm not seeing any questions yet, so I will also launch our poll for individuals to participate in. If you can please take a few moments to fill out the poll, that would be great. We are both nonprofit agencies, and it would be wonderful to be able to receive your feedback so that we can make sure that we're doing a good job for you. And we will hang out while you do that and see if any questions come in. Dylan says right now, there are no questions on Facebook either. So please feel free to enter your questions into the chat box on Facebook or on Zoom while we give you a few moments to do so and to fill out our poll. I want to thank Kathy and John both for a wonderful presentation and reaching out and collaborating with Maine Parent Federation to bring this information to our families. They have provided the guide on I'll post it again just down here below, just so that you can see it in the chat box. And they will also be, I'll be giving them the link to the recorded webinar, and they'll be posting it on their website as well with their professional closed captioning. We tend to use YouTube because financially we can't afford what Maine Site does, but they do a wonderful job and have a much more professional closed captioning, so you'll be able to access it on their website as well with full closed captioning. So I still don't see any question. Oh, wait, I've got two that popped up. Hold on. What type of accessible education materials is common for dyslexia?
Want me to take that one, Kathy? So,
We're planning a webinar on that, I think, aren't we, John?
We're working on one that actually will probably take place in the fall.
Good question.
We do have ones that are already on the website. I would answer immediately that there is a program available, free program available to all students in Maine, all students in the country. And by students, I mean students at any age, including college students and adult ed students. The program is called Bookshare. It has, last time I looked, several hundred thousand digital books that are everything from textbooks to traditional trade books in a digital format. They actually have the formats in Braille Ready format. They have it in DAISY and several different formats. There's a free online reader, browser reader that you can use. I call those devices adapted reading or e-reading applications. So it simply will take the digital text and allow the student or the individual to manipulate that and make it more useful. They can change the font size, the color, the font itself. They can have the e-book actually read out loud to them, so it converts from text to speech. All that's freely available to U.S. citizens who are students at any level. So check out Bookshare, go to the Maine AIM website and learn more about how to get a free membership for Bookshare. There's also another program called Learning Ally, which we talk about, which is specifically audiobooks, books that have been converted into audio files with human speech narration. That's also a service that schools can use, but that is a service that requires a fee. So you have to get a membership for that, and that costs something. But the Bookshare service is completely free to everybody with a disability, who has a print disability. So, and almost all the software now that you need, the AT software that you need, is free of charge as well. So,
John, is there anything that can read handouts that might be passed out during class?
Well, first of all, we work very hard with schools to make sure they don't do that.
They do, yes.
But if they do, surprise, surprise, there are a number of programs that will allow you to quickly scan a printed piece of paper, even if it's in handwritten form, and it will do its best to try to interpret that handwriting and convert it into a workable text and actually do convert the text to speech. In fact, I just attended a webinar yesterday about that the Microsoft people put on, And they have now a free product called Immersive Reader. It was only available in the school version, but now if anybody who has a copy of Microsoft Office on their computer and they have the latest version and any operating system, including the tablet version and the online version, has essentially a high quality e-reader built into the app that will not only do text to speech, but it will also read handwritten stuff, including math. That was the one that surprised me. It will, for those of you who have difficulty with math, it will actually take handwritten math equations and read them out in English to you. Why didn't they have that when I was in high school?
Yeah, no kidding. And I find my son has dyslexia, so the 504 and IEP are really, they're valuable in most disabilities, but as we have evolved with Noah and his dyslexia and as he's grown through the years at school, when you get to a point of note-taking, there's all different things that are available for note-taking. And some kids don't want to look different than the rest of their peers. So we've arranged that Noah gets a handout for each of his classes where he gets the teacher's notes. And we make sure that this is clear for Noah. That doesn't excuse him for taking notes. He still needs to do his best to take notes, but he can get a copy of the teacher's notes so that he can, in case he misses something, he doesn't panic. And he's also allowed to record classes. So we use all three tools for him so that he can make sure that, it helps him to go back and listen to the recording while reading through the teacher's notes so that he can then highlight what he feels like is important and was emphasized in the class. And it'll leave some of that stress and anxiety that I know comes with dyslexia. The diagnosis of dyslexia, anxiety, and ADHD is very common. And so some of those accommodations and modifications really help to ease that anxiety, especially in the classroom. The parent had mentioned that their child is headed to ninth grade. So something to think about as you do get to high school, the ownership falls a lot of times on the student's shoulders, and you can work with that student on self-advocacy goals. And those are some of the things that we've done with Noah, but and making sure that he's advocating for what he needs and having those written into his 504 plan. He did have an IEP, now has moved to a 504. You as a parent being aware of some of the things that are available can help your child to advocate for what they need. What do you do if your school does not have a voc rehab counselor? So every high school is supposed to have an assigned voc rehab counselor. I don't know, Diane, if your school is in between voc rehab counselors, but I am not aware of a high school that does not have an assigned voc rehab counselor. I think what happens is a lot of voc rehab counselors are covering multiple schools. And so therefore you may feel like your school doesn't have one, or they're not available, or the school hasn't introduced you to the voc rehab counselor. And a lot of times they do have a difficult time, or it's challenging for them to get to every transition IEP meeting because they're covering multiple schools. But every high school should have a voc rehab counselor assigned to them. And if you are, Diane, do you mind sharing what every public high school should have one? Diane says no, they stated they did not have one. In that case, Diane, can you provide me with your email address? And I'm going to give you Libby Stone Sterling's email. She's the director of vocational rehabilitation, and I would recommend advocating with her as to, there's no list. The only list that I've ever been able to get of voc rehab counselors has been provided to me from Libby. And so Libby would be the individual to get in touch with to ask who the voc rehab counselor is for your district. I don't want to ask you who your district is here because I don't want to put them out there. But if you don't mind typing your email address into, you can do it right here in the question and answer box, so only I have it. I will forward you Libby's email address, and we can hopefully get an answer for you on that. And then Danette Pelletier says, can you provide details on how parents can borrow equipment?
Yeah. Oh, thanks, John. Carrie, I'll add to your comments about the VR counselor. They do not work for the school. I think I've met some parents before that thought that was part of the school team, and they come in from the quote-unquote outside. They're state employees. And they're mandated by federal law to provide services to transitioning students. So they come from the state vocational rehabilitation system. So as Carrie said, Libby Stone Sterling runs that system statewide. They are regionalized. So if you know who your region is, you can call that area. But yeah, why not email Libby and ask who's assigned to your region of high schools. As Carrie said, usually they have a number of high schools clustered that they're assigned to work with students. So they're busy people, but hey, they do great jobs for those students who are transitioning.
Yeah, and sometimes they're not housed in the high schools. I found a lot of them are housed if your district has a adult ed program. They're housed in the adult ed program sometimes too. But I will email you, Diane, and provide you Libby's information, and she will most certainly get you connected.
Great. The question about getting access to equipment is you go on the website, atformaine.org. And I won't call this the Craigslist of AT, but it's very intuitive, pretty easy to use. And you go on the website and you can create an account for yourself, or you can just search if you don't want to yet create an account, just search. So John's sharing with me here. I want to search for an iPad, John. I'll make it easy. Want to search for an iPad. So John has typed in iPad, searching for iPad. So up pops iPads. And as I said, we've got a number of them. And just click on one, John, the iPad Pro. And it'll identify for you, the viewer, scroll down where it's located. This one happens to be up at the UMaine Farmington location. It's available for loan. Et cetera. It gives you the location. And then it allows you, if you want to pursue that, it allows you to go into the system and to set up an account and communicate with UMaine Farmington and initiate a conversation. There's the phone number for them or the email for them. The contact, their loan period is only 14 days. All four of our entities that have equipment, the loan period is only 14 days, but quite often, if there's not someone waiting for that device, another 14 days can be allowed for renewal. So anyway, but it's relatively simple to do. If you get stuck on it, call us or email John or I, and we'll help you through it. But it's a relatively intuitive basic website for you to explore equipment. So John, can I ask you to go back up and just pop open the categories, and just so people can see categories and examples of categories of equipment. Look at all of that. Lots of categories of equipment. Now, I'm not saying we have something that fits into every single category, but this is the examples of categories. And as I mentioned earlier, we've got more than 1,200 devices in the system and adding more every year as we get resources to do so. So anyway, that's kind of how you go for it. Thank you. Is that helpful? Thanks. Does that help?
Thank you, Kathy. And then also, if we can, I just wanted to check in the chat box. Rachel Merriam is a VR counselor who works in the Augusta offices and offered her assistance as well, Diane, to you. She put her number in there. She gave you a link to the rehab, Evoke Rehab site as well. I will include Rachel's information as well in the email that I send to you. So that you have it after the webinar concludes. And Danette says she was one that asked the question about borrowing equipment, and she said, yes, thank you, Kathy.
You're welcome.
So I am not seeing any other questions.
One just popped up in Q&A, but
back
to Danette. By the way, this is a free service, and so in some cases, you may be able to arrange to pick up the device, or they may ship it to you and have to ship it back. So you'll want to discuss that with whoever you borrow it from. But the actual equipment is free to borrow.
And then what popped up in Q&A was just Diane saying thank you. So I don't see any other questions at this time. If you don't have any other questions, we can conclude the webinar. I think Kathy and John and I will just hang for a few more minutes just in case something pops up. But the polling has been completed, and we want to again thank Kathy and John for their time. Please feel free to add a question if you have one. If not, thank you for participating, and please go and enjoy the rest of this beautifully sunny day. Summer has arrived, finally, so please enjoy it.
Thank you
all. Just another thank you. Thank you, guys. That's always helpful for me to see too. So
what do we have for attendance? I couldn't see the numbers.
We had 23 total, and we had 14 people complete the poll. So I will get, probably tomorrow morning, I'll get the attendance list to you. I'll send you everybody who registered as well. The list gives you, well, you know how that works. You guys are familiar with Zoom. I'll give you the link, and I'll total the poll results for you.
And we'll get you the information about that ABLE Act webinar. We're still in the development stage, and we haven't
cool.
But that would be of real interest, I think, to a lot of parents.
I attended yours last week, Carrie, so I was very interested to hear about it. We're working with another attorney from Maine up in the Bangor area to present end of July, so it'll be good. Can always over and over.
Thought it was interesting. It really highlighted for me how far behind I am in my estate planning. I had a special needs trust set up for Sammy because we did that prior to the ABLE counts were even created. I had a couple grandparents pass away. My parents had put in lieu of flowers, please donate, because my grandparents wanted to contribute to Sammy. So, which was really, really nice. But I was like, oh, I need to get this put together. So she does have a trust, but I haven't, you know, obviously there's no formal estate set up yet, but it highlighted for me the need to get into my financial planner and start putting that stuff together and have something written up. But it was interesting. It's definitely interesting on the different information you get from the different people.
Right.
I don't think they were as well versed on ABLE accounts as they were on the special needs trust. So, let me know when you put that together.
Our webinar is planned to be just on ABLE.
Yeah, cool. So, definitely. I mean, you always send us your stuff and we get it up, but
it is going to be July 30th at 1:00.
Okay.
But the information is not posted yet, so we're still working on that.
All right. Well, thank you.
Thank
you guys enjoy the rest of your week and your Zoom meetings.
All right. Thank you.
Have a good one.
See you guys.
Bye. Bye-bye.